Well, hello there, my friends, and welcome to Park Church. Pastor Darryl here welcoming you to worship this day. I'm so pleased that you have found this open and affirming congregation here in downtown Grand Rapids, Michigan. But I want you to know that no matter who you are, where you come from, or wherever you are in your journey through life, however, wherever, whenever you may be accessing this online worship service, I want you to know that you are loved by God this day, that you are so welcomed here at Park Church, and I do pray that you and yours are happy, healthy, safe, and well. As we gather this day, as we continue to look and ponder and explore the meaning of the Lord's Prayer, we're going to maybe dig into what might be the most confounding and controversial of all of the petitions of this prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Or you might have grown up with trespasses or sins. We're going to look at that today, so I'm glad that you are with us. But on this beautiful day that our Lord God has made, I hope that as we join together in beloved community, you will check us out online through the website, through Instagram, through Facebook, that you will download and subscribe to our Congregationalist newsletter so you can stay connected and be informed and more importantly, get involved in our ongoing mission and ministry here at Park Church. Also, if you have a prayer concern, please email that in to us. We really want to be able to join you in prayer and hold your prayers in our hearts this day. So now, my friends, as we join together through the power of the Holy Spirit and Christian love, let us now enter the sanctuary space and begin our worship as we lift up our songs and prayers and go to God in worship now.
Our scriptures today are found in the book of Leviticus and the Gospel of Matthew. I will first be reading from Leviticus 25, verses 8 through 17, and then from the sixth chapter of Matthew, verses 9 through 12. Listen for the word of God for you this day, for God is still speaking. from Leviticus. You shall count off 7 weeks of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the period of 7 weeks of years gives 49 years. Then you shall have the trumpet sounded loud. On the 10th day of the 7th month, on the Day of Atonement, you shall have the trumpet sounded throughout all your land. And you shall hallow the 50th year, and you shall proclaim liberty throughout the land to all its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. You shall return every one of you to your property, and every one of you to your family. That 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. You shall not sow or reap the aftergrowth or harvest the unpruned vines, for it's a jubilee, and it shall be holy to you. You shall eat only what the field itself produces. This year of Jubilee, you shall return, every one of you, to your property. When you make a sale to your neighbor or buy from your neighbor, you shall not cheat one another. When you buy from your neighbor, you shall pay only for the number of years until the Jubilee. The seller shall charge you only the remaining crop years. If the years are more, you shall increase the price. And if the years are fewer, you shall diminish the price. For it is a certain number of harvests that are being sold to you. You shall not cheat one another, but you shall fear your God, for I am the Lord your God. And from the Gospel of Matthew, pray then in this way: Our Father in heaven, may your name be revered as holy. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Here ends our reading, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Jill, you read that so passionately. I think there were going to be some people here who were going to cheat, but then you said, do not cheat one another. And I think you turned some people around today. Good job. Dude, that was beautiful. Honestly, that was so read so beautifully. Thank you so very much. So here at Park Church, we are an eclectic bunch of people coming from a lot of different theological backgrounds. I know that there are some folks here at Park Church who grew up as trespassers, right? Yeah, some trespassers here. And there are some of us who have been proud debtors our entire lives. And there are some of you here today who are sinners. Well, according to our visitors outside with the sign and the bullhorn, we're all sinners here at Park Church. I mean, potty mouths, come on. All of us are sinners, according to that sign. Grade A premium cut sinners. And this denominational diversity often occurs within one family unit. I was talking to some folks who have been worshiping with us here at Park over the summer weeks, and they mentioned to me last week that they really liked being here at Park. They particularly have enjoyed that we've been using various versions of the Lord's Prayer in the worship services. They like it because One of them grew up a good old Presbyterian debtor, and the other one grew up a lifelong Methodist trespasser, and they've been, as they've been going to different churches during the summer, kind of church hopping and shopping, they've kind of built up this little rivalry between them. Whenever they visit a new church, they said, they look in the bulletin and they see if what version of the Lord's Prayer that the church is using, and they want to make sure that the church is using the right Lord's Prayer, depending on whatever their definition of the right Lord's Prayer is. And they said to me, all very tongue-in-cheek last week, that it's been nice to come into Park during the summer weeks because then they could let that rivalry go because each week we've been changing it and they have no idea what the words are going to be. But then one of them did turn to me as they were about to leave and they said, but we're really looking forward to the sermon this week because we're hoping you will be able to settle this for us once and for all. All right. Never one to back away from a challenge. Let's settle this, shall we? And let's begin by getting nerdy. Let's look at what these scripture verses say in our Bible. This prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray appears in 2 out of the 4 Gospels, but you already knew that. And the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Matthew, they have different versions of this petition in their various versions of the Lord's Prayer. Luke reports Jesus teaching us to pray, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. While Matthew, on the other hand, he makes no mention of sin. Rather, Matthew reports Jesus saying, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And my friends, that's not a typo. The Greek words here for sin and debt could not be more different from each other. It's not like people got confused in listening and hearing Jesus. He definitely uses different words here. And the gospel writers, and this is not controversial, chose the version that they liked best. So what about trespasses then, you might be asking? Well, trespass is nowhere in the Lord's Prayer. Some of you debtors like, I told you. Trespass doesn't make its debut in any Bible until 1526, when it was introduced for the very first time in the English language in what is called the Tyndale Bible, when it was translated by William Tyndale. Now, Tyndale was eventually deemed a heretic, and he was executed in 1536. And the Tyndale Bible was banned from being read by any person in England. But nothing, right, Camille? Nothing sells a book like it being banned. And nothing moves a book all the way up to the New York Times bestseller list like a scandal. So you can't tell a whole country they can't read a book. They're all going to go buy it. And that's exactly what they did. Tyndale's Bible became an overnight sensation and so popular and so read by the English-speaking world that English speakers to this day use Tyndale's version of the Lord's Prayer. Episcopalians, Methodists, Baptists, English-speaking Catholics, they all use trespasses. And I can't tell you how glad it makes me that our Bible-thumping Southern Baptist friends are all praying a heretical version of the Lord's Prayer that isn't in the Bible. The irony of that just is so amazing. It makes me so happy. Oh my God, it's so good. It's so very good. We Reformed folk, you know, Congregationalists, Presbyterians, Christian Reform, and the like, we took our cue from good old John Calvin, and he landed on debts and debtors. But now that I think about it, he too was deemed a heretic by the Catholic Church, so I see that I'm aware of the speck in my neighbor's eye and not noticing the log in my own. But since debts and debtor is the heretical version of the Lord's Prayer that we use here at Park, I want to focus on that phrase for just a little bit longer. Because there's more going on there, my friends, than just it being geek, it being just a Bible geeky thing going on. I have come to believe in my heart of hearts that Jesus really meant for us to pray debts and debtors, and he did so for a very good reason. And in doing so, he very intentionally introduces economic language into the prayer. Now, hear me out on this. When Jesus teaches us to pray, give us this day our daily bread, he is reminding us that people need to eat. And now that he introduces debts and debtor language, he is introducing economics into the prayer. He is reminding us of this very basic truth that if any of us has ever been in severe debt, we know to our core that debt, not metaphorical debt, not spiritual indebtedness, but real life debt can be crushing to the human spirit. Simply not having enough money to live on and giving all of our money and interest to the banks due to a debt can crush a person from the inside out. It can impoverish a person from the outside in, and it can bring a literal hell on earth to the person living under such a burden. And that's what makes this first century prayer so relevant for us in the 21st century. Because we all exist underneath a globalized capitalistic umbrella around the world. And there is extremes amount of debt going on. Because capitalism is sustained by debt. That is macroeconomics 101. We have been taught that a market will collapse. It will cease to exist if debt is forgiven. So when we in our churches spiritualize this petition, when we substitute sin or trespasses for debts, we are missing out on a very specific thing that Jesus wants us to be about. Because debts is unequivocally an economic term, just like sins is undeniably a theological term, just like trespasses has everything to do with violating someone else's private property. And let me just be very clear. There is merit, a great deal of merit. I just spent the whole children's moment talking about the merit of forgiving people their sins against us. And our sins against them. And there's very much a moral imperative that Jesus teaches us as his followers to be about that kind of forgiveness. He just doesn't do that in this prayer. He does it in 11 other teachings in the Bible. But that is not part of the Lord's Prayer. Because you see, my friends, by using this debt and debtor terminology, Jesus is talking about forgiveness in the economic realm of things. He is marrying mercy with equity. He is marrying charity with justice. And I have heard it said somewhere that something that God has joined, no one should tear asunder. Jesus is drawing on a long, hoped-for tradition in Judaism that is called the Year of Jubilee. A year of joy that is instituted by the forgiveness of financial debt. As Jill so amazingly read for us from the book of Leviticus, you shall count off 7 times 7 years, and then you shall sound the trumpet loud, and you shall hallow the 50th year, and you shall proclaim liberty throughout the land to all of its inhabitants, and it shall be a jubilee for you. And in this year of jubilee, all debts, no matter how large, no matter if you've been paying it back for 1 year or 49 years, they are all forgiven, gone. And all the land that was held as a pledge against that debt, it's returned to the original family. This year of Jubilee is an old, old dream, and one that the prophets of Israel never gave up on. It's a dream that the early church tried to live into. It was a dream of St. Francis, of St. Clair, of Dr. King. It was a dream of President George and First Lady Barbara Bush when they announced in the Rose Garden that there would be a year of jubilee for the continent of Africa in the mid-2000s. It is a dream of President Biden in forgiving student loan debt for low-income Americans. Both of these jubilee efforts were found unconstitutional by the courts in the United States, but unconstitutional is not unchristian. And it's a dream that we shouldn't give up on either. Because it's the dream of Jesus himself. This year of Jubilee was evoked by Jesus when he preached in his very first home synagogue when his public ministry was just beginning. And as you can imagine, the rank and file people of Nazareth, they heard this as very good news. But as you can imagine, it went over like a lead balloon with a powerful land-owning, debt-holding aristocracy. And this dream of Jesus nearly gets him killed because he threatened the existing order through the forgiveness of debt. But Moses and the prophets and Jesus himself, they all believed in the year of Jubilee. They saw it as a way of repairing the world. They saw it as a way to do justice with charity. They saw it as a way to do equity with mercy. They saw it as a way to restore relationships, to heal the broken places in society, and to ease the inequalities of our world. My friends, when Jesus taught us to pray, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors," Jesus is teaching us a jubilee prayer. And even though it is an old, old prayer based on an older, older dream, it's still relevant today. 500 years after Jesus taught this prayer, still no year of jubilee had been declared. But that didn't stop St. Gregory of Nyssa from writing a sermon on the Lord's Prayer. And I want you to listen to what good old Gregory has to say about this petition, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." St. Gregory writes, "Since God is good and just, we must be good and just. This means that anyone who oppresses a debtor is moving away from the love of God. How can there be any communion with God when we deal cruelly with one another? No, Christians show our faith in God in the readiness to forgive our debtors. This is the very meaning of Jubilee. For there is no greater joy than knowing that in being merciful ourselves, we have mirrored the mercy of God." Let me bring St. Gregory into the 21st century with a little story about a youth group from the great state of Texas. Because these young people definitely took the words of St. Gregory to heart. Back in 2022, a youth group from Friends Congregational Church in Bryan College Station, Texas, they raised $50,000 for the specific purpose of forgiving over $5 million in debt that was being held against their neighbors. How did they do this? Well, on their annual summer mission trip, which was themed Charity with Justice, they learned that falling into medical debt was surprisingly easy, even for people who have health insurance. And they found out that medical debt is something that happens to everyone around the country. They learned that in the United States, nearly 30 million adults are in medical debt collections, and they owe over $220 billion in medical debt. And they learned that medical debt can cause severe emotional and spiritual harm to those individuals and their families. Individuals with medical debt experience significantly higher mental health problems, such as anxiety and depression. And they learn that crushing individual debt has a drastic effect on the community at large, affecting everything from budgets to police and fire response to truancy in school. But they also learned how for every $100 raised, you can forgive $1,000 in debt. And you know what they thought? We can do that. So they set themselves a goal of $15,000, and they quickly surpassed that. Then they raised the goal to $25,000, and then $30,000, then $40,000, and finally, after 6 months, they raised over $50,000. That's a lot of pancake breakfasts and car washes. They put in a lot of hard work to raise that money. And then the Friends Congregational Church Youth Group partnered with a nonprofit organization called Undo Medical Debt. And you see, when someone can't pay off their medical bills, that debt is often sold, pennies on the dollar, to a collection firm. And if they can't collect the money, then it's sold to another agency. And that's when Undo Medical Debt steps in at this point to purchase the debt using the money raised by charities, like the $50,000 that the Friends Congregational Church Youth Group raised. So this youth group from Texas raised $50,000. And in doing so, they were able to forgive $5 million of medical debt for their neighbors in Brazos County and Central Texas. What relief these youth brought to the lives of those being burdened by debt. What joy, what love they birthed into the world. These efforts of these young people at Friends Congregational Church were literally answering a person's prayer. And their good work literally answered the prayer that Jesus teaches us to pray. So, my friends, let me bring it home to you like this. Today, right now, in Michigan, there are 1.3 million Michiganders in medical debt collections. Our neighbors, those who live around us, owe over $2 billion in medical debt. These are the people in our neighborhoods, many of whom have health insurance, all of which are living in their own personal hell being caused by crushing debt. And all throughout this sermon series, during this summer, I've been giving us concrete ways, week after week, to make this prayer come alive. So today, I'm just hear me out. Can we bring a little jubilation and jubilee to our neighbors being crushed by medical debt? Now, I have an idea. Every Advent and every Christmas season, we take up a Christmas offering. It's an amazing tradition here at Park Church. And if you average out the last 2 years, we have averaged taking up $13,000 in this Christmas offering because of your generosity. So I'm wondering, can we, this Advent and Christmas, can we work with a trusted agency like Undo Medical Debt, and can they be our Christmas offering partner? How much joy could we bring to our neighbors if we raised $13,000 in our Christmas offering? I reckon that's about $1.3 million worth of Christmas gifts. How liberating would that be for our friends, our neighbors, for them to be freed from this burden of excessive debt? Do you think that might feel like an answered prayer? Do you think that that might feel like jubilation? We pray every single week, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And we do so, and no judgment, I do it myself, we do so casually. But what if we took it seriously? And we took it with the intent that Jesus wanted us to pray it with. I think that might feel like charity with justice. I think that might feel like jubilee. And I'm not sure that settles it, but it could settle a debt. And I bet that would feel like good news. Amen and amen. My friends, I would invite you to join your hearts and your spirit with mine as we go now to God in a word of prayer. Loving God in whom we move and have our being, hear our prayers this day. Incline your ear to us and grant us your peace. For may the meditations of our hearts and the words of our mouths be found acceptable unto you, so that as we go forth from this place, we do so filled with your Spirit to walk in the ways of Christ, reflecting his forgiveness and mercy, and bearing good fruit of your peaceable reign on earth as it is in heaven. For we come to you now in prayer, lifting our petitions in intercession for the suffering of our world. We pray for those ailing in body, mind, and spirit, those in need of a healing touch, recovering from surgery, battling and fighting chronic conditions. We ask that you would comfort them and strengthen them as they heal. And we lift up Ron and Marty, John and Bruce, Judy and Liz, Mike and Bob, and so many more. Work through the doctors and nurses and caretakers so that they may be agents of your healing grace, O God, as you coax people back to the fullness of health. And we pray for those who live in an uncertain and violent world. We pray for a ceasefire today in Gaza, a release of the Israeli hostages today, protection for Palestinian children today, and for things to calm in the Middle East. We also pray for peace in Ukraine and Congo, Venezuela and Bangladesh, and all places around the globe, O God, struggling for justice and human rights. We pray for those who are grieving and mourning. We pray for Riley and the Jensen family. We pray for Ellie Mott and the Greater Holland family. May they know your grace, O God, found in every tear and every cherished memory recalled. And may they know your persistent, abiding presence in this time of grief. And we pray for your beautiful creation, O God, that we would be inspired to walk humbly upon it, that we would be merciful to it, and we would curb our behaviors that have caused the climate to change and the earth to warm. And we lift up those dealing with hurricanes and wildfires and extreme weather, O God, may they know they're not alone in their recovery and rebuilding. And we pray for safety and joy for our children, our families, our educators, and our school leaders and staff as a new school year begins. Be with the poor, the unhoused, the unemployed, and those without enough resources and too much debt to meet their basic needs. This we pray, O God, along with our silent prayers and the meditations of our hearts. And we pray in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, our rock and our Redeemer, adding all of them to the prayer he came teaching us to pray. Our Father in heaven, help us to honor your name. Come and set up your kingdom so that everyone on earth will know and follow you as you are known and followed in heaven. Give us our food for today and forgive us for doing wrong as we forgive others. Keep us from being tempted and protect us from evil. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, good people, our worship this day is coming to a close, and I'm so pleased that you have been with us. I hope that this time together in worship, offering our prayers, lifting our songs, hearing God's word, has inspired you and been a blessing unto you, lifting your hearts and filling your spirits. I also want you to continue and to ponder and to pray how you might partner with us here at Park Church on how we may use our Christmas offering in the months to come to help alleviate medical debt for our neighbors here in West Michigan. I hope when that time comes, you will partner with us. But now, as our worship does come to an end, won't you join your hearts and your voices with mine as we lift up the words of our common commission so they may be written on our hearts so that we may live them out as agents of Christ in the world. Let us now go forth into the world in peace, being of good courage, holding fast to that which is good, rendering to no one evil for evil, strengthening the faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the afflicted, honoring all people, loving and serving the Lord, and rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. My friends, our worship has come to an end. Let us go out into the world with God. Let us go out into the world in peace. Amen and amen.